everybody, and welcome to this Värt att veta, worth knowing. As you know, this lecture will be broadcasted, and you will be heard on the screen. You will be or heard on the screen film if you stand in front of the camera or when asking questions after the lecture. And as you also probably know, the questions will be after the seminar, and then I will go around with the microphone so we get the questions and answers in the broadcast and in the film. So today, Shaojun will talk about delicious mushrooms, pre-processed wood for bioethanol production. And Shaojun is from the Department of Forest Biomaterials and Technology here at this faculty. And it is not common that a forest can be used for both energy and food, and Shaojun will talk about this. And if you didn't know it, I will tell you that the soup, the mushrooms in the soup, is actually from Shaojun. So it's extra delicious this time, so I hope you enjoy it. So I welcome Shaojun on the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to Chairman for the nice introduction. And many thanks for organizers for providing this opportunity for me. Okay, we start with some background. Oh, sorry, should use this one, right? Yes. Today, we are living in a world with many challenges. The top challenges we can summarize here. One is the growing population. You know, by 2050, there will be 2 more billion people coming to this world. We need to consider resources, food, and fuel. Second top challenge is climate change, which is driven by greenhouse gases. Also, perhaps you know, actually, it's also related to the way we are living, we are producing. Related to those two challenges, there is one more issue, that's a land use issue. Perhaps you remember some years ago, there was a discussion, and even today, about food and fuel, regarding how people use cereals to produce first generation of biofuel, ethanol. For us, being researchers, we have the commitment to develop something, to develop carbon and this resource-efficient holistic solutions. One important strategy we are thinking and we are doing is to consider use local resources for combined food and fuel production. Here, I emphasize food and fuel, not food or fuel. Here in Sweden, we have so much forest residues which could be used for both food and fuel. In this respect, we think edible mushrooms could play a very important role, which is what we have been studying in recent years and also what I'm going to talk today. Many of you may be familiar with this chain. The production of second generation of biofuel from lignocellulose to bioethanol. It's the non-food. The first step is along this chain is the pretreatment, which is to separate lignin and release the cellulose. And this process is the most important, extremely important for next step, enzymatic hydrolyze cellulose to sugar, and the next step, and hydrolyze cellulose into sugar, then the sugar would be further converted to the ethanol. There are many different pretreatment methods today, but most of them are very expensive. Around 30 to 40% the cost of the total expenses for whole chain is used for this pretreatment. Among different methods, physical chemical pretreatment is dominant one and the common one. But it is requirement for that is tough. We need to have a intensive energy input. For example, if we use this steam explosion, we need to have the steam at least 180 degree and pressurized steam. We need also corrosive chemicals like sulfur acid or sodium hydroxide, depends on different the method, which measure you are going to use. Also, related to that, we need to have expensive equipment and maintenance of the equipment. After this treatment, we need to handle the waste. We think there is possibility to use edible mushrooms. They could do a better job. The process is like this. We, for example, if we use forest residues, first for substrate to grow the mushrooms. After growing mushroom, the substrate is going to be used for the rest process to produce bioethanol. The key here is that, you know, the fungal species must be white rot the fungi. That species, that this, you know, this group of the organism have the ability to secrete lignin degrading enzymes. So in that way, after our harvesting mushroom, the substrate spends some substrate has a very low level of the lignin. So that material could be easily hydrolyzed and go in rest of the process. So we name this process as a fungal pre-processing. With this process, we not only get the ethanol, bioethanol fuel, but also the food. So this picture is from our research, and it shows those major components change before fungal pretreatment and after. You can see here the lignin and xylan were dramatically degraded by the shiitake mushrooms. What about the mushrooms? We know mushroom is a protein-rich food. And you can see the mushroom, two common mushrooms, even have a higher nitrogen content than vegetable cheese. Edible mushroom, the importance of edible mushroom is beyond the people's diet today. In 2008, there was a published study, which was financed by NASA. That was about using edible mushrooms for space life supporting system. Look at those keywords. So the mushrooms are also important for our future. many generations after. Recently, you know, this biological pretreatment or this fungal pre-processing has been attracted by many scientists. And it's believed that this method would be important for future bio-based production. Now, I'm going to tell you what we have done. In recent years, we have been focused on to study the major factors that may influence the both mushroom production and also this lignocellulose degradation. So these factors include physical, chemical, and biological. About the physical factors, we have been focused on pasteurization media and temperatures. There is also an ongoing experiment in which we are looking at the effect of the substrate density and particle size. Around the chemical factors, the focus has been on this initial substrate composition due to either those three major components, three species, or additives, nutritional additives. Three hardwood species have been included in our research, that is birch, alder, aspen. We also studied additives, for example, like bark and the nitrogen. The nitrogen source, we use the we have got very interesting results for that. We hope in a couple of months we will get the publication about it. We have also compared different fungal species, namely shiitake, oyster, and chicken mushroom, and wood ear, and so on, to look at their production, both production and ability for this processing, pre-processing the wood. In collaboration with colleagues, here up the fourth floor in Department of Forest Ecology, and the colleague in Biosystem and Technology in RNAP, we have also identified some kind of symbiotic species. Look at this, those pictures. Yeah, this one is pure shiitake mycelia. Another one is the mycelia, shiitake mycelia in substrate with bacteria species, special bacteria species. Sorry. Yeah, one of the most important progress in our research is this, which has been published earlier this year. It was about this pasteurization method. It's worth saying something about it. Shiitake is a very sensitive species. To the growing environment, especially those competitive species. And it's also the one of the most difficult species to be cultivated. But this species, so far we have found the best in degradating of the lignin. So, but around the world today, people often use autoclaving for pasteurization. Pasteurization is a very important step, but people often use the pasteurization. That means 121 degree steam at the 2 bar at least. So you can imagine how that needs a lot of energy, also equipment and the maintenance of the equipment. What we did is to study the hot air. instead. So this is the result from our study, the yield. And you can see the T1 here is from the steam or pasteurized substrate. That means 121 degree at 2 bar. T2 to T5 are from pasteurization by hot air. From 100 degree, that's the T2, to 75 degree, that's the T5. Although there is a little bit higher, the yield, but in general, I would say they have a comparable, at least a comparable yield of the shiitake. This guy was the one approached me several years ago, and he was asking me why you use steam to pasteurize the substrate. Is that possible to use hot air? Then 2 years later, we took this picture. In his right hand, that is from 85 degree hot air pasteurized substrate. In his another hand, that's autoclaved substrate. So he was very happy. Now we look at that results from this lignin degradation. This is the mass degradation. You can see after growing mushroom, lignin content was dramatically decreased. And the compared different treatments from the autoclaving and hot air, I would say the results are comparable. Although there is a difference in between, it shows a little bit higher here, but statistically, not very significant different. So, the hot air should be much easier and cheaper to produce. So this suggests that we don't have to use steam, but hot air should make the process easier, also practical. And from the energy analysis, balance analysis, we can get to the conclusion that if we use 85 degree hot air, could save up to 60% of the energy that is used for autoclaving. The requirement for fungal preprocessing should be much easier now. Especially when we introduce this hot air. Now, the pasteurization needs energy, but around 80 degrees for shiitake should be enough. For other mushrooms, for example, oyster, could get even lower temperature of the hot air. So, and these mushrooms could be grown or cultivated in-house and with room temperature or even below room temperature. Fertilizers and pesticides are not necessary. The last one is this requirement. It needs 90 days for shiitake. It looks like a weak point compared to the thermochemical pretreatment. It's too long. But you know, we can get the food as a benefit instead. So far, we have studied a lot to use this shiitake as a model species in our research. because we thought that if this species works, then other species should be also easier to get into the system. In reality, this shiitake, as I mentioned earlier, shiitake is one of the most difficult species to be cultivated. Another two species I listed here could work also, although the efficiency would be lower. Another two is the green oyster and the king oyster. I think you could buy them in the market. Some of you may be wondering Yes, raw material or substrate. What substrate people can use? Here is the simple one. We have tested many times. Don't forget, the hardwood residues are mostly from, you know, thinning, forest thinning, and they don't have any economic value in Sweden today. This is a very simple calculation to give you a clue how economic look like. So if we start with 1 ton of the birch-based substrate, I mean dry mass, we might get 600 to 700 kilo shiitake fresh mushroom. This fresh mushroom means 90% moisture in it. Then after that, there will be about 50 to 60% the dry mass left. We can use that for further process to produce ethanol. According to our research, for shiitake system, we could produce 130 to 140 liter of 95% fuel ethanol. Here is not pure ethanol, definitely, because we use the 95% as a fuel. This is relevant to, you know, around 79 to 85 liter of regular gasoline. Okay, this almost done. Taking this opportunity, I would like to thank all my colleagues in these years for their inspiration, for their supporting and hard working. I also would like to thank financiers and industrial partners. Okay, thank you. I hope it's not too long, right?
Great.
Okay.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. So now to questions. Do anyone have a question? You have a question.
Very nice presentation. My question is that the ethanol production, you say it's 95% ethanol. What is the energy requirement to process usable concentration of ethanol from this process? What is the, if you ferment the residue from the mushroom cultivation, what would be the concentration in that step?
That is a good question. From a mushroom part, you know, firstly it's the pre-processing part, the energy, you know, compared to the physical chemical pretreatment, it's much, much less. You don't need to consider so much about it. But from the enzymatic part and the rest part, to be honest, I don't know exact figure yet. But we just compare the normal process. Compared to its physical chemical process, we should have the energy consumption is much lower.
Some more questions? That's good.
Thanks, very interesting. I was wondering if you can separate the mycelia after you have cultivated from the rest, from the residues of the substrate. I mean, the white
thing. Yeah.
Is it possible, or is easy, or difficult?
That is a very good and interesting question. We are struggling about that. We wanted to do that. But it's still in the discussion. Problem is that mycelia would grow inside the cell. So So how to separate that? If it's outside, it's okay. How to separate inside the cell? So that's a very, I don't know yet, to be honest.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. I was just wondering if different species of mushroom will yield different amount of ethanol, or is it species specific ethanol production?
Yes, you are right. Definitely different species could have the different ability to degrade lignin, and the yield and the conversion that would influence the cellulose and the yield. So far, we have found that compared to other species, shiitake is the best.
Thank you for your talk about combining food and fuel, and now on forest land also. Very interesting. But tell me what's in front of you. You haven't told us yet.
Yeah. Yes. You mean how to make it? Okay. This part is the biomass part. We for this experiment, I think we used the exactly that the recipe I showed. 80% of the birch, including a part of birch bark, and 20% of wheat bran. That is you call the veta clean, right? Yes. Then mix with water and put in the plastic bag, and then go into the pasteurization. After pasteurization, we put the mycelia, it's inoculum, and after a couple months, we get this colonization. You know, the sawdust, and there should be this color. Then this white part, that is the mycelia, grow everywhere. Then sometime around in 3 months, we will get these mushrooms. Yeah, is this what? At least shiitake.
You will all have the opportunity to come here and ask Shaojun more questions after this talk. But now some more questions.
Yes, thanks a lot. From a biological and chemical point of view, this seems to work really fine, and it's very interesting. But there is also another problem. It's of a pedagogical nature. I mean, we need to come with some kind of pedagogy to make consumers, to make people understand how wonderful mushrooms are. I eat lots of mushrooms, but many people almost never eat mushrooms. Maybe they don't know anything about. So we have a big challenge here when it comes to pedagogy and to explain why and how and things like that, and how to use mushrooms in food and when cooking or everything. So I just wonder, what do you plan to make to on the pedagogical point of view so people understand how wonderful mushrooms are? Thanks.
Good, I agree with you. We need to do some more work in education. I would love to be participating any program can give this knowledge.
Yes, a common to eating mushrooms is that vegetarians often eat corn, and corn is a fungi.
Well, I'm wondering, also related to that question about how to make people understand that mushrooms are useful. How close are you to get something to be more operational, and what are the project partners' involvement, and what scale can you imagine?
Yeah, it's true. Swedish market is very small, and in Sweden, there are so many mushrooms in nature. So, and compared to other countries, I read the figure is in Europe, 2.5 kilo per capita consumption of the mushroom. In Sweden, not counting those nature ones, I think it's 1.3, something like that, around half. So this is a reality. Also that, anyhow, now I have been working with the industries. They are eager to establish something in Sweden, both for producing the mushroom itself and those substrates ready to grow mushroom. Today in South Sweden, there are some growers, they import this substrate and to get the mushroom. This substrate is ready to, you know, develop to fructificate the mushroom. When they buy this one through those cold container, for example, from Poland and Germany, and then they grow this within 1 week. The partners I'm working here in West Boden, actually in the process, they want to establish one. The one I can mention is that you know in Hannes Trær Gold, they are very interesting have a new production, a line of the mushrooms. Actually, last week I had a meeting there.
Have to stop there, and you can come here and ask more questions, I think, and look at the beautiful mushrooms. And maybe in the goal to eat more mushrooms, you can eat some more great, delicious mushroom soup. So thank you very much for a very interesting talk.
Thank you.